Hello everyone. Today's topic is about mandibular first molar anatomy. Okay, so these mandibular molars, they are larger when compared to other mandibular teeth. So compared to all the mandibular teeth, the mandibular molars, I'm not talking about first molar here, the mandibular molars are the larger teeth when compared to any other mandibular teeth. And an important question is, the permanent mandibular molar is developed from five lobes. Okay, there are five cusps in the mandibular molar. So it is developed from five lobes. Remember these, we'll talk about it later. Next, the crown completion of this mandibular molars takes place at 2.5 to 3 years. So the crown will be completed by 2.5 to 3 years. So if suppose there will be any developmental disturbance, it will take place during this period. That means from the birth. So the initiation, the first evidence of calcification is at birth. Okay, whereas the crown completion is from 2.5 to 3 years. So if suppose there is any developmental disturbance during this period, during the formation of the crown, then it will manifest, this developmental disturbance will manifest in the crowns. Okay, so the eruption is usually 6 to 7 years, and the root is completed by 9 to 10 years in the mandibular first molar. Okay, so first evidence of calcification is at birth, whereas the crown is completed by 2.5 to 3 years. So any developmental disturbances like hypoplasia or hypocalcification, if they occur during this period, they will manifest in the crowns. Okay. So now we'll start with the mandibular first molar anatomy. Okay. So it is the largest tooth in the mandibular arch. So mandibular molars are the largest teeth in the mandibular arch, whereas out of which the mandibular first molar is the largest tooth in the mandibular arch. Okay. And it has five well-developed cusps. Okay, it has five well-developed cusps, out of which two buccal cusps are present, two lingual and one distal. So here you can see the mesiobuccal cusp, distobuccal cusp, small distal cusp, and lingually we have two cusps, mesiolingual and distolingual. So there are five well-developed cusps. So out of which the mesiobuccal cusp is wider mesiodistally. So it is the largest cusp when compared to all the five cusps. Okay. Whereas the distal cusp is the smallest cusp. Okay. Next. Yeah. So it has two well-developed roots. So we have seen that it has five well-developed cusps. It has two well-developed roots. So what are these roots? Mesial root and the distal root. So one mesial root and one distal root. So these roots are broader buccolingually. So they are broader buccolingually. Okay. And they are widely separated at the apex. That means there is a furcation here and these two roots are separated at the apex. So there is a greater distance at the apex. Next, the dimension of the crown mesiodistally is greater by about 1 mm than the dimension buccolingually. So when compared to the buccolingual dimension, the mesiodistal dimension is greater. That means this mesiodistal dimension is greater when compared to the buccolingual dimension by about 1 mm. Okay. Next, although the crown is short cervico-occlusally, the crown is short, but because of these mesiodistal and buccolingual measurements, there is a broad occlusal form for the mandibular first molar. Okay, mesiodistally, the crown is 1 mm greater when compared to the buccolingual dimension. And even though the crown is short cervico-occlusally, since it has the mesiodistal and buccolingual measurements which are greater, there is a broad occlusal form that is provided for the mandibular first molar. Okay, so now let's talk about each aspect. So first one is the buccal aspect. So this is very important. It is trapezoidal. So in the buccal aspect, it appears trapezoidal. So it is like this. So there is uneven cervical and the occlusal outlines. So it is appearing trapezoidal. And if suppose we are viewing the teeth from the buccal aspect, so what are all the cusps that we are seeing? We are able to view all the five cusps. Isn't it? So this is the mesiobuccal cusp, distobuccal cusp, distal cusp, and we are even seeing the lingual cusps also. Lingual cusp tips are also visible from the buccal aspect. Okay. So there are two lingual cusps in the background, the tips of the lingual cusps in the background, whereas the three buccal cusps are also visible. Okay. Next, there are two developmental grooves. These are the mesiobuccal developmental groove and the distobuccal developmental groove. So, So the mesiobuccal developmental groove and the distobuccal developmental groove. So where is this mesiobuccal developmental groove? So it is exactly in between this, the end of the mesiobuccal developmental groove is exactly in between the center of this cervical and the occlusal regions. So the terminus of the mesiobuccal developmental groove is at the center of the dimension of the cervical occlusal length of the crown. Okay, whereas this is the distobuccal developmental groove. The distobuccal developmental groove, the terminus is at the distobuccal line angle. So this is the distobuccal line angle. This is the mesiobuccal developmental groove. Okay, so here on the occlusal aspect, you can see the mesiobuccal developmental groove. So from the buccal aspect, it is entering onto the occlusal aspect like this. Okay, so this is the distobuccal developmental groove. So where is the mesiobuccal developmental groove? It is acting as a line of demarcation in between the mesiobuccal cusp and the distobuccal cusp, isn't it? Whereas where is the distobuccal developmental groove now? It is in between the distobuccal cusp and the distal cusp. Okay, so mesiobuccal developmental groove is acting as a demarcation. It is separating the mesiobuccal lobe or the mesiobuccal cusp. So in the posterior teeth, the lobes are nothing but cusps. Okay, lobe is nothing but a portion of the teeth. Okay, so the mesiobuccal lobe and the distobuccal lobe is separated by the mesiobuccal developmental groove, whereas the distobuccal lobe and the distal lobe are separated by the distobuccal developmental groove. Okay, so now, as you can see in the picture, the mesiobuccal cusp and the distobuccal cusp, they are flat. Okay, whereas the lingual cusp, you can see a sharp outline, right? So the mesiobuccal cusp and the distobuccal cusp are relatively flat. And an important feature is flattened buccal cusps are typical of mandibular molars. So for mandibular molars, there are flattened buccal cusps that are seen. Okay, so here you can see that the lingual cusps are, there's a sharp outline. When compared to this, the buccal cusps are having flatter surface. Okay, next, the mesiobuccal cusp, as you can see, as I've already mentioned, it is widest mesiodistally of all the three cusps. Here three cusps means we are talking about only the buccal aspect, right? So on the buccal aspect, we see the three cusps. So here, out of the three cusps, the mesiobuccal cusp is widest mesiodistally. Not only of the buccal cusps, out of all the five cusps, the mesiobuccal cusp is widest mesiodistally. Okay, and it has some curvature, but is relatively flat. So as we have seen earlier, it is relatively flat. It is having a little bit of curvature. Whereas the distobuccal cusp is also, so here you can see the mesiobuccal cusp is flat. The distobuccal cusp is also relatively flat, but compared to the mesiobuccal cusp, it is having some amount of curvature. Okay, so mesiobuccal cusp and distobuccal cusp, they are flat, but compared to the mesiobuccal cusp, the distobuccal cusp is having somewhat a greater curvature. Okay, it is almost as wide as that of the mesiobuccal cusp. Okay, next, these two buccal cusps, the mesiobuccal and the distobuccal cusp, what are they doing? They are making up the major portion of the buccal surface of the crown. So as you can see, the buccal aspect, the major portion is formed by this mesiobuccal and distobuccal cusp, whereas only the smaller portion is formed by the distal cusp. Okay. So now, the distal cusp, as we already know, it provides a very small part of the buccal surface. So the mesiobuccal and distobuccal are making the major portions, whereas distal cusp is only making a smaller part. Okay, and this major portion of the cusp makes up the distal part of the crown. So this is the mesial part, this is the distal part, right? So this is making up the major portion of the distal part of the crown, and it is providing a contact area. Okay, so it is providing a distal contact area, okay, wherein the next tooth will contact. So it is acting as, it is providing a contact area. Okay, next. These three cusps have, or as we have already seen, the mesiobuccal and distobuccal grooves as the lines of demarcation. Okay, so we have seen this, the mesiobuccal groove and the distobuccal groove as the lines of demarcation. So as I've already told you, the mesiobuccal, where is it terminating? It is terminating exactly at the center. Okay. So, and it is shorter when compared to the distobuccal developmental groove. Okay. The mesiobuccal developmental groove is short when compared to the distobuccal developmental groove. Okay. So, next one is about the cervical line. So, this is the cervical line. Okay. So, this cervical line is usually regular in outline. Okay, remember this buccal aspect, on the buccal aspect, the cervical line is regular and it is dipping apically towards the root bifurcation. This is called as bifurcation. Okay, so this portion of undivided root is called as root trunk. Okay, root trunk is nothing but the undivided portion of the root. The distance from the CEJ to the entrance of the furcation is called as root trunk. Okay, whereas this divided portion is called as bifurcation. Okay, it's called as a furcation area. Okay, so this cervical line is dipping towards the root bifurcation, isn't it? So it is facing towards, it is dipping towards the root bifurcation. Okay, next. The mesial root is, so this is the mesial root, this is the distal root. Okay, so the mesial root is broad and it is curved distally, isn't it? So it is curving towards the distal aspect. So immediately, below the cervical line, it is curved mesially. So initially, from its point from the cervical region, it is curving mesially, but finally it is tapering at the apex and its direction is towards the distal aspect, isn't it? Whereas the distal root is less curved when compared to the mesial root, isn't it? The mesial root is more curved, whereas the distal root is less curved. The distal root is less curved than the mesial root, and it is, where is it ending? It is towards the distal direction. Okay, so the distal root is towards the distal direction, whereas the mesial root is curved distally. Okay, so the mesial root is broad and it is curved distally. The distal root is rounder and it is broad at the cervical portion. It is broad at the cervical portion and it is pointed in a distal direction. Distal root is distal. Mesial root is curved distally. Okay, next. The point of bifurcation, so is this is the point of bifurcation, right? So this point of bifurcation is approximately 3 mm below the cervical line. So from the cervical line, the point of bifurcation is 3 mm below the cervical line. So this is equal to the mesial bifurcation length of the maxillary first molar. So this is an important question asked. So same, the maxillary first molar, the mesial bifurcation is also having the 3 mm only, okay, from the cervical line. Okay, and next, where is this mesial root ending? This mesial root is ending directly below the mesiobuccal cusp. Okay, the mesial root is ending directly below the mesiobuccal cusp. And it is somewhat, this curvature is somewhat mesial to the crown, isn't it? If this is the crown, when it is curving like this, this curvature is mesial to that of the crown outline, right? Whereas the distal root, this, because of this curvature, it is little bit distal when compared to the crown. Okay, I hope it's clear. Next, we'll come to the lingual aspect. So in the lingual aspect, so when we are viewing the tooth from the lingual aspect, we see two lingual cusps and the lingual portion of the distal cusp. So we are viewing three cusps, whereas from the buccal aspect, we saw five cusps. Okay, because the tooth is broader. The tooth portion is more from the lingual aspect. It is covering the buccal cusps. Okay. So we can only see the mesiolingual cusp, distolingual cusp, and a smaller portion of the distal cusp. So distal portion, lingual portion of the distal cusp. Okay. Next, there is a lingual developmental groove. So just like we saw the mesiobuccal developmental groove, distobuccal developmental groove, we have the lingual developmental groove. What is lingual developmental groove doing? It is acting as a line of demarcation in between mesiolingual cusp and the distolingual cusp. So it is acting as a line of demarcation in between two lingual cusps that are present. Okay. Next, cervical line. So what did we see in the buccal aspect? From the buccal aspect, the cervical line is regular, whereas from the lingual aspect, the cervical line is irregular. It is irregular and it is sharply pointing out towards the root bifurcation. And what did we see? The distance from the cervical line to the furcation region is 3 mm on the buccal aspect, right? So here it is 4 mm. Okay, on the lingual aspect, the furcation distance is the distance from the cervical line to the furcation line is 4 mm from the lingual aspect. Okay, so here an important aspect is the roots appear longer lingually when compared to the buccal aspect. So this is the buccal aspect, this is the lingual aspect. So what happens is the roots are appearing longer in the lingual aspect when compared to the buccal aspect. So ideally what happens is, what did we see? This distance is 3 mm. This distance is 4 mm. That means the cervical line is placed more towards the coronal aspect, right? So the roots are measuring about 1 mm longer lingually than buccally. Okay. But even though there is only 1 mm difference, we can see that there is this length seems more. Okay. So even though there is only 1 mm difference, the length seems more. This impression is because lingual cusps are sharper. Okay. They are highly pointed. Lingual cusps, as we all know, the buccal cusps are flat, whereas the lingual cusps are highly pointed. Because of this highly arranged higher lingual cusps, and because of the cervical line, which is present more towards the coronal aspect, it gives an impression that lingual side from the lingual aspect, the roots are longer when compared to the roots on the buccal aspect. Okay. Next, the mesiodistal measurement of the root trunk is less towards the lingual surface than towards the buccal surface. So this is the root trunk. So we all have the idea about this. So from the cervical line to the point of furcation entrance. So this mesiodistal measurement of the root trunk is less in the lingual aspect, whereas it is more towards the buccal aspect. Okay. And the root bifurcation starts at approximately 4 mm below the cervical line. So now, this is equal to the buccal bifurcation length of the maxillary first molar. So in the maxillary first molar, you will have roots like this. Okay. So this distance is also 4 mm for the buccal. This is the buccal from the buccal aspect. So this distance in between the cervical line to the buccal bifurcation is also 4 mm only. Just like that in case of lingual aspect of the mandibular first molar. Okay. So next we'll come to the mesial aspect. So if we view the tooth from the mesial aspect, we see two cusps. And we see one root. What are the two cusps that we see? It is the mesiolingual cusp and the mesiobuccal cusp. Okay. Whereas we can view only one root, that is the mesial root. Okay. So we see two cusps, that is the mesiolingual and mesiobuccal cusps. And we see one root, that is the mesial root. And the buccolingual measurement of the crown is greater in the mesial portion when compared to the distal portion. So the buccolingual dimension is greater on the mesial aspect when compared to the distal aspect. Same thing, the buccolingual measurement of the root is also greater than the mesial distal aspect. So now an important thing. So if we are viewing the teeth from the mesial aspect, the buccolingual measurement is more. So we won't be able to view the distal part, isn't it? So from the lingual aspect, same thing with buccal and lingual. Since on the lingual side, the tooth is broader, when we are viewing the tooth from the lingual side, we are not able to view the buccal cusps, right? So same thing with that. Mesial portion is broader when compared to the distal portion. Okay. So the mesial portions are broader and the mesial cusps are higher. Okay. Because of which we won't be able to view the distal aspect. Okay. Next, here also, the cervical line is irregular. Okay, it is irregular and it curves occlusally. Okay, it is irregular. Yeah, and the crown from the mesial or distal aspect appears roughly rhomboidal. So it is rhomboidal in shape in case of mesial, from the mesial or else from the distal aspect. And the entire crown will exhibit a lingual tilt in relation to the root axis. Okay. An important point I forgot to tell is, in the lingual aspect, the mesiolingual cusp is placed at a higher level when compared to the distolingual cusp. Okay. The mesiolingual cusp is at a higher level when compared to the distolingual cusp. Okay. Yes. So from the mesial aspect, the mandibular first molar and mandibular second premolar have some differences. Okay. So there are, other than these differences, most of the aspects are same in between the mandibular first molar and mandibular second premolar from the mesial aspect. Okay, so what are these? The mandibular first molar, the crown is a fraction of millimeter to 1 mm shorter in the first molar. So the crown portion is from the mesial aspect, it is a millimeter shorter in the first molar when compared to the mandibular second premolar. Whereas the root is also much shorter in the mandibular first molar when compared to the mandibular second premolar. And the buccolingual measurement of the crown and root of the molar is 2 mm or greater or more greater when compared to the mandibular second premolar. Whereas the lingual cusp is longer when compared to the buccal cusp in case of when compared to mandibular second premolar. So this is the comparison in the mesial aspect. Okay, the mesial aspect of the mandibular first molar compares to the mandibular second premolar in these four aspects. Okay, next. So we have seen the buccal, lingual and the mesial aspect. Now we'll talk about the distal aspect. We have already seen on the distal aspect also the crown appear, the shape is rounded. Okay, so the gross outline of the crown and root are similar to that of the mesial aspect. So almost it is similar to that of the mesial aspect. But as I have told you, the more tooth is seen from the distal aspect. So mesial aspect is broader. So distal, from the mesial aspect, if we view, we cannot view the distal things. Okay, the cusps or the structures that are present on the distal aspect. Whereas more tooth is seen from the distal aspect. The distal aspect is narrow. So here we can view different things. So here, if you can compare, see in the mesial aspect, we are seeing only the mesiobuccal and distobuccal, mesiobuccal and mesiolingual cusps. Okay. Whereas here in the distal aspect, we can see more amount of tooth structure. We are even seeing the mesiobuccal, distobuccal cusp, distolingual cusp, distal cusp. Okay. So distobuccal cusp. So all the cusps we are able to view from the distal aspect. Okay. Next, we'll come to the last aspect, that is the occlusal aspect. A very important question is, from the occlusal aspect, it appears hexagonal. Okay, so this should be your option. But I have referred to one question in the dental pulse, wherein the option was given, trapezoidal was given as answer. Okay, hexagonal was not given in the option. If hexagonal is given in the option, you need to opt for hexagonal, which is more appropriate. Okay, but if hexagonal is not given, then you need to go with the trapezoidal. Okay, so occlusal aspect, it appears hexagonal, and on the occlusal aspect, it is 1 mm greater mesiodistally when compared to the buccolingual dimension. We have already seen this. So the crown is 1 mm greater mesiodistally when compared to the buccolingual dimension. Okay, and the buccolingual measurement of the crown is greater on the mesial than on the distal aspect. So on the mesial aspect, if you can see this buccal lingual, right? The mesiodistal, it is greater when compared to the, on the mesial side, the buccolingual dimension is greater when compared to the distal side. Okay. So this is buccal, lingual, mesial, distal. Mesiodistal dimension is greater when compared to the buccolingual dimension. And on the mesial aspect, the buccolingual dimension is greater when compared to the distal aspect. Okay, I hope it's clear. So here, it is greater mesiodistally than buccolingually, right? So for maxillary first molar, it is greater buccolingually when compared to mesiodistal dimension. Okay, so it is just opposite in case of maxillary first molar and mandibular first molar. Okay, so now, the mesiobuccal cusp is slightly larger than either of the two lingual cusps. So as we have already seen, this mesiobuccal buccal cusp is larger when compared to the buccal cusp, when compared to the lingual cusps also. So out of all the five cusps, the mesiobuccal cusp is the larger cusp. Okay. Whereas the distobuccal cusp is smaller than the other three cusps. It is smaller when compared to the mesiobuccal cusp, mesiolingual and distolingual cusps. Okay. So which is smallest? The distal cusp is smallest. Okay, so mesiobuccal cusp is slightly larger, or it is larger when compared to all the five cusps. Distal cusp is smaller when compared to mesiobuccal, mesiolingual and distolingual cusps, whereas the distal cusp is smallest of all. Okay. Yeah. So here, when we are viewing the tooth from the occlusal aspect, we see some important important descriptions that we have to learn. Okay, we see some fossa, we see some grooves. So what are all the things that we see? So we see a central fossa. So this is the central fossa. Okay, when we are viewing the tooth from the occlusal aspect, what are all things that we are seeing? So we can see a central fossa, and there is a mesial triangular fossa, distal triangular fossa, and as we all know, mesiobuccal developmental groove, distobuccal developmental groove, central fossa. This is the lingual developmental groove, and we are seeing the mesiobuccal cusp ridge, distobuccal cusp ridge, distal cusp ridge, mesiolingual cusp ridge, and the distolingual cusp ridge. SG supplemental grooves. Okay, sometimes the short grooves in addition to the developmental grooves are called as supplemental grooves. So these are all the things that we see in the occlusal aspect of a mandibular first molar. Okay, thank you everyone.